So first, my name is Ori Rafael. I'm lucky to be one of the two founders of Absolver. I come from a data engineering background. That's basically what I've been doing for the last 16 years. And I want to start by talking more about the inspiration for this benchmark. And the inspiration was basically came from our customers. We talked to a bunch of customers that are using an ELT approach today, so running their pipelines within Snowflake. And I think they are very happy with Snowflake itself as a query engine. It is a great database. But they were complaining about the pipelines that when they were running them in Snowflake. Some of them were talking about the cost, the fact that they're actually paying more for pipelines than they are paying for queries, which is the purpose of why they bought Snowflake. Others spoke about the fact that their business wants to see data in real time, and they weren't able to really create that streaming ingestion, that streaming latency within Snowflake. And others were just talking about the ELT process itself. Some had very simple pipelines. So one step from my raw data to various aggregated tables that I'm actually connecting to my BI dashboard. But some had much, much more complex pipelines. Some of them, I remember looking at DBT maps and I needed to scroll down between pages to kind of see the entire map with many different staging tables. And we wanted to also visit that part as we are doing the benchmark. So we started this benchmark with, before we started this benchmark, about the data set and how we ran the benchmark. So we generated an e-commerce data set with 16 billion rows and representing 5 days of transactions. And out of that stream of events, what we did is created four tables. One table that just represents the raw data and allows you to do any research that you want. And the other three tables are more specific projections on top of the raw data. So how did my sales perform? How was my performance per geo? So various reports that I would expect to see in BI dashboards. We only did three aggregated tables. Usually we see dozens of tables like that. But three were enough to understand the benchmark. We wanted to get to 1 minute data freshness. That was our starting point. We didn't stay there throughout all the options because of some limitations, which we will review in a few minutes. But that was definitely our goal. And the third, we decided we wanted to go with the native approach to do our aggregated tables. I'll explain more what native means, but basically I think declarative is maybe the best word to describe it. I have raw data, I have a final table, I wanna create one SQL operation that takes me from A to Z without too many staging tables or kind of bending over backwards to be able to get to the final step, because it's not really sustainable if I have dozens of aggregated tables. The data pipeline piece needs to be simple. So the first approach we decided to look at is the one we know. We know AppSolver pretty well. We know Snowflake. We decided to use AppSolver, which is a data pipelining system, to write into Snowflake. AppSolver runs all its processing in the lake before Snowflake. So we're actually only writing the process data into Snowflake instead of using Snowflake as the compute engine that calculates our aggregated tables. For this data set, we needed the smallest AppSolver there is, which is 4 cores. Also because we are not really using Snowflake to run this compute, we can basically work with the smallest Snowflake possible. And we only needed 3.5 seconds for every 60 seconds of data. So we basically chunked the data to bits of 60 seconds, and each bit of 60 seconds took us 3.5 seconds on a Snowflake extra small cluster to finish the ingestion. The total process was 34 seconds, so 30 seconds was the time it took AppSolver to create all the raw data table and all the projection tables we talked about. The cost here is $20,000 per year, but mostly because this is the minimum that AppSolver takes for customers it actually manages. The AppSolver instance was at 30% utilization. We could also get it to 80% utilization, probably running double that scale for the same cost. So just to make you to help you get more familiar with where Absolver fits in the data pipeline flow, so in the data, actually the data flow. So Absolver connects to sources that have complex data. So those can be sources, can be streaming sources or file sources on object storage like S3 or databases. And it ingests the data from them into the lake, runs processing within the lake, and then writes the data to targets. You can write the data to a query engine directly that directly works on top of the lake, like Athena or Redshift Spectrum or Starburst or Dremio. And I could connect the data to what we are talking today, to Snowflake, to Redshift, and to other databases. Those, this is kind of the function that AppSolver fulfills for the customer. And AppSolver itself is in data infrastructure. It means that you deploy it within your own account on your own bucket. It is fully managed in your account, but it is running in your account like any other data infrastructure. Last slide on AppSolver, I wanted to show you an example of how the system looks like, so you'll have some sense of that. What you see here on the left is a schema that represents our data set, our raw data set. This is auto-generated by AppSolver during ingestion, so I can see exactly what data I have. And what you see here on the right, and this is very important, because sometimes AppSolver can be confused with Snowflake. AppSolver is not a query engine. Your queries, you do them in Snowflake. Your pipelines, you do them in AppSolver. So this SQL doesn't represent a query, it represents a job, which means that every event coming from my source is being processed with this SQL logic, creating my target tables. In this case, it's showing me the performance of my e-commerce operation in a specific city and state. That's how I created it. So all I needed to do is write these 12 lines of SQL, actually 11 lines of SQL, and to create the table in Snowflake, it took us, I don't know, in the minutes range to create that, that output into Snowflake. So we had a baseline, the AppSolver ingestion into Snowflake. We knew how much it cost. We saw the latency that we got with this 1 minute. We said, let's try to do the same and get AppSolver out of the picture. Let's try to write in Snowflake every 1 minute. And we used several approaches to do that because there isn't just one way that fits all. So the first one we looked was to use Snowflake merge syntax for SQL, very native. Basically, I want to create a table. I can upsert into a table. That's what merge does. Doesn't take too long to write that merge operation. And the second approach we wanted to look at was temporary tables. So this is the DBA technique. Instead of writing into my aggregated table, I'm writing into a staging table. There are no queries from that table. And once the table is ready, I just rename it and rename the old table. So I'm basically switching the two tables and deleting the old one. I was an Oracle DBA. I did this a million times, I think. And the third approach we wanted to use is materialized view, because materialized views are really great in defining projections on top of raw data, and they are native to mutable data. So city, every time I'm seeing more data on the city, I want to aggregate the results. So a materialized view lets me do that in a very good way. And Snowflake has a materialized view feature. So out of these three that we tested, you can see that it took much more than 60 seconds to process 60 seconds of data. So it took me, in the best case, was 436 seconds to process 60 seconds of data. And that's a problem. Like if I'm looking at that and I'm comparing it to what it took with AppSolver, it means that I can't really do with either of the, with these three approaches, I couldn't get streaming working into Snowflake. And that makes a ton of sense because Snowflake is a database, it runs a batch operation. And every time I want to update the last minute of data, I need to match that with all the data that I already accumulated. So that operation takes time. And if I'm running that operation every minute, it's not really sustainable for our data set of 16 billion records. So we basically just needed to scrape this option and said, okay, I can't load the data every 60 seconds to Snowflake. Maybe I don't have to, maybe I can look at other alternatives, but this alternative was not something that we could make, that we can make happen, make work. So we decided that we'll go and take a look at the third approach. And the third approach was, let's touch the data freshness a little. Instead of writing to Snowflake every minute, let's write every hour and see what's going to happen with the performance. And we're still using the same techniques that we're using that allow us to do a one-step pipeline. So we had materialized views, and we had temporary tables, and we had merge commands. And we found out that, first of all, this works. Like, you can write to data, the data every hour into Snowflake in a pretty simple process. But the challenge here was cost. So the cost of doing this operation every 1 hour in Snowflake was much higher than the cost it took us to run Absolver on the exact scale. So 3x was the minimum. And if you use materialized view, it was actually 4x. But I think it's actually much more than that, because if you are managing a continuous pipeline process in Snowflake, you need a tool for that, or you need to spend some engineering time to manage that process. So usually you would use a third-party system, maybe dbt, to run this ELT process. That will incur more cost, and this cost is not included here. All we included here was the cost of Snowflake, or in the red, the cost of Snowflake plus Absolver. Maybe one more thing to note, we kind of came into this benchmark with a very cost-oriented state of mind, but we actually found out that there are some stuff that we are doing with pipelines that can really save a lot of time comparing to the work in Snowflake. Our data set was a nested data set, not a very complex, not too many fields, but it's still a nested data set. And the first thing we did when we tried to load that into Snowflake is to store the JSON files we had in a Snowflake stage, turn that into a Snowflake flat table, and from that create a projection. But once I have a bunch of JSONs stored in my database, it doesn't mean that I actually understand what the schema is. I need to start querying a bunch of samples and trying to understand, based on those samples, what's actually the schema for me to create the flat table. That process took a while. More like in Absolver, it's auto-generated. It took us six hours just to get through that and creating the first flat table with all the raw data. And then creating the aggregates was easier because we used materialized views and merges. But it still took us a few hours to script the pipeline job that's run on Snowflake and kind of play with the transformation. And when we wanted to make changes in this process, it took us about a couple of hours to get it from start to finish. This is, if I'm comparing it to writing a pipeline on something like Spark, this is a dream, but it's still something that needs to be considered. If I'm spending 15 to 20 hours per new pipeline, if I have a lot of pipeline, that's something that I need to think about. In Absolver, it took us about an hour to do the entire process with all three aggregates, because the orchestration happens automatically, and the management happens automatically, and the infrastructure is managed automatically. So I basically don't have a lot to do except just writing the transformation. So this sums up the third approach. And then we decided that we want to look at the fourth approach. What could, if I wanted to do some kind, I want to bend over backwards, try to reduce that Snowflake cost. Can I actually do that? And we talked to people that implemented Snowflake a billion times, and they kind of know all the tips and tricks and hacks. And what they're saying is that, listen, you want to create aggregated tables. And those aggregated tables basically are the reason that the cost becomes very high. If you just wanted to write the raw data, that's not a big issue. I could do that with Snowpipe, I could do that with the copy commands. But once I start to, I want to create different tables that actually hold a transformation like aggregations, that's a problem because the process is batch. So maybe what we can try and do is pre-aggregate the data and then aggregate the aggregate. So like a two-step aggregation process. That process can make the Snowflake a little, the operation in Snowflake a little lighter to do, and cost would probably go down. And I actually wanted to go and implement that option, But the challenge was it just took too long to do. There are three problems that we saw with this approach, and those consultants we talked to shared these problems with us. The first is this is reminding us of the data, of the Lambda architecture and all the problems that come with Lambda. So if I have JSON file coming from S3, I'm putting them in a stage, I'm getting to a Snowflake raw table, and then I create small aggregates, like hourly aggregates. Those hourly aggregates give me the freshest data possible. In the end of each day, I'm gonna take these aggregates and turn them into daily aggregates. So when I wanna actually run a query, what I need to do is to combine my hourly aggregates with my daily aggregates and make sure both are in sync. There is some duplicate logic that's happening there. It's out of like any Lambda architecture. It's definitely not a one-step pipeline. There are many more dependencies that I need to cover. And I also need to make sure that I'm keeping hygiene. And so if I'm creating temporary data in the form of hourly aggregates, I need to go and clean those up afterwards. Otherwise, cost would come from a different direction. But I think maybe the biggest problem is this pattern only applies to append-only use cases. So once I aggregated the data, I'm using these aggregates. If there is a change, I don't know how to apply this change. So if there is late data coming, I can't really go and change the aggregates without recalculating all the aggregates. This is why the world is working so hard on adding upsell capabilities to data lake tables. This is why Snowflake has merge operations, because the ability to do an upsell into my store makes this limitation of append only go away. I think this is a pattern that has been used a lot in traditional EDWs, but as upsell capabilities get better, this approach is being abandoned more and more. And it's actually not serving any purpose, except maybe reducing some costs. So doing a merge operation into Snowflake gets me exactly the result that I need in a very small amount of time and effort, but it's gonna cost me more. So the only purpose this architecture is serving is trying to reduce cost. We decided not to complete this exercise. We talked to a bunch of people that know Snowflake, and the price we got to do this was 500 hours to actually run and implement this process for our data set. It was way too much. We invested a couple of hours doing the AppServer piece and maybe 20 hours to do the Snowflake piece. So doing 500 hours just to implement this is something that we decided not to do. And it's very obvious just from that estimation what's the downfall of this approach. It's just the complexity. Like, I can't create many pipelines that do this without moving all my costs from software to more headcount. So that was approach number four. And I want to kind of try and sum up what we have learned from this very educational process. I think the first thing that we learned is that you can't really do streaming into Snowflake with ELT. That's, of course, only if you use aggregation, but who doesn't use aggregation? So basically, you can't really do streaming into Snowflake with an ELT approach. You need to move your transformation down into the data lake, have the process data, put that in Snowflake, and use Snowflake as the serving layer. So if your project has a very strict data freshness requirement, this is definitely something that we have checked. I don't think you can do that with an ELT approach. The second thing that we learned is that ELT is much more expensive than we thought. We thought that, once we are going to change Snowflake from 1 hour processing to, sorry, from 1 minute of processing to 1 hour of processing, so we kind of decide to sacrifice streaming and do something that's batch, the cost is still 3 times higher than doing the streaming process in AppServer. I could maybe get the Snowflake cost to match, but then I will need to write every few hours into Snowflake, not every hour. So we were kind of surprised with how expensive ELT is. And that actually aligns with what our customer told us, that there, many of them are seeing a higher consumption invoice on the ELT warehouse comparing to the query warehouse. Of course, that's not including the Airflow and DBT part of things. This is just the Snowflake cost. And I think the next thing I wanted to focus on is the process, the development process itself. What I said, one step or multi-steps. Snowflake gives you the ability to do a one step. AppSolver is a one step platform. That's what makes it unique. It is a declarative data pipelines platform. You just do one SQL only transformation that moves you from your raw data to your final process data. But the thought approach and how complex it is and how long it takes to do, that surprised us a little. Like, I didn't think it's going to be that much of a difference. I'm a DBA. I'm all for doing some hacking for cost, but 25 times more hours per pipeline to do this was way too much comparing to what we were expecting. Other than that, I personally had a lot of experience with building Lambda architectures in the past. I hated them then, and I hate them today. The fact that you need to have duplicate code and temporary copies, and I need to clean that up, that's kind of the work I hated the most as a data engineer. All of that work that's not really serving anything for the business, it's only serving cost, but eventually it's not really serving cost because my time is also worth something. The last thing that we learned that was a little surprising for us was the materialized views in Snowflake. We definitely think materialized views are super valuable when you're doing BI and you want to create dashboards. You just define the output that you want as a result of a query instead of doing insert, update, delete. It's a much more declarative way to define our table. But apparently, materialized views in Snowflake are not really for frequently changed data. When we started to dive into the documentation, that's actually listed in Snowflake's documentation. So materialized views are great. Use them, but be aware that you don't need to use, they're not a tool for every use case. They're a tool when your data doesn't change very frequently. It was very easy to set up the materialized view in Snowflake. I would definitely use it when I can use it. This use case that we tried wasn't a good fit for the materialized views. And that's it. I hope that I didn't review that too quickly, and I'm happy to go dive into questions and see what you think. And hopefully this was valuable for you. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thanks for that, Ori. So we do have one question specific to Spark, because you mentioned that. It says, you mentioned Spark. Can you talk about how AppSolver is different from Spark and other ETL tools?
Yes, of course. So I think those are two questions. So I'll answer Spark and then other ETL tools. So Spark is a pipeline platform. I mean, I'm talking about the pipeline part of Spark, not the ML part or the query part of Spark. I'm talking about Spark pipelines. They can virtually do any use case. And AppSolver is the same. In Spark, you work with code, Java, Scala, Python, on top of files that you usually keep on object storage. We come from a DBA background. Our inspiration has always been databases. And we created AppSolver because we didn't like that alternative. It was too slow for us. So the AppSolver approach is to run SQL over schemas like you do in databases. This is why I showed the schema on read in the beginning and the SQL that AppSolver runs on top of it. AppSolver can virtually do any use case that Spark can do, but we do it with an SQL approach and over schemas instead of code over files. I think that if you like to work with databases, AppSolver is going to be a much friendlier tool for you. If you like to write code, then Spark can be a much better tool for you. Maybe it's a question of flavor. I think that one big advantage I want to add there is the fact that AppSolver pipelines are declarative. Like, you don't need to do all the work you do that's not transformation. Like, in Spark, I write my transformation, but I still need to orchestrate my jobs. I still need to make sure that I clean the data copies. I need to do a lot of stuff that are not just transformation. In AppSolver, I only do transformations. That's it. AppSolver takes this transformation and turn them into a production pipeline orchestration, for example, which is a huge, huge time waster. All these DAGs that you need to do, all of that is automatically generated by Absolver. So the difference from Spark is basically ease of use and the ability to use SQL. It means that we are saving data engineers time, and we are actually allowing analysts and data scientists to create their own pipelines. They don't have to go through data engineering for everything. For me as a data engineer, it's very nice that someone is not opening tickets for me. So that's the difference from Spark. Now, ETL tools, when you say ETL, it's a very broad question. It can be, you know, the old Informatica or the new five trends of the world. I think they're very focused on connectors. So there are more orchestration tools that take your data from one connector and put it to another, to put it to a target. The emphasis here is not on transformation. AppSolver's focus is complex data that requires a lot of transformation. That's why we have connectors for streams, for files, and for databases. ETL tools don't have the transformation capabilities that AppSolver have. So if you're the focus of your project is transformation, AppSolver would be a great fit. If you need connectors for a bunch of third-party SaaS applications, then a traditional ETL tool would be better for you. So you have ETL tools for connectors and for transformation. You can have Spark and you can have AppSolver. They're basically achieving the same function. And of course, you have ELT tools like dbt. So ELT tools run on Snowflake compute. AppSolver runs on Data Lake compute, which is exactly what we compared today.
All right, thanks for that, Ori. And we have another question specific to Iceberg. Does it, and I imagine, Ralph, you mean AppSolver, support Iceberg, and how well? I think this is a good segue on our Parquet format.
Yeah, so I said earlier in the webinar that AppSolver has data warehouse target and it has data lake targets. So Iceberg is related to the data lake part of things. Today, AppSolver integrates with the Glue catalog and with the Hive Metastore. So any engine that can integrate with one of these two can query AppSolver data. Iceberg is another catalog for us. So we are planning, this is not in the product yet, but we are planning to have support for Iceberg, which means that AppSolver is going to create a table that stores data in Parquet, and the metadata for that table, actually here it's the manifest, are going to be in Iceberg. So this is coming soon, please stay tuned, not in the system yet, and please feel free to reach out to us for more specific pipeline and more specific timeline and tell us more about what you want to do.
Yeah, we have one question here about the declarative pipelines and a clarification on, it said simple declarative pipelines in the presentation, and can you talk more about what that means for AppSolver?
Yes, declarative pipelines are pipelines that let you only write transformations. So you have a source, you write transformation, in AppSolver you do it in SQL, and all the rest is automated. I think to help create a visual image, think of what you do with databases. I go to database, I write a query, and I get a result. I'm not spending time on defining the execution plan. I have the database optimizer to do it for me. AppSolver is the pipeline optimizer. You submit an SQL transformation. AppSolver turns that into a job. We figure out how to orchestrate this pipeline, where to put an index, which operation to do before. If you want to think about like what's the order of the MapReduce, what are the different chunks, like how to do parallel processing on top of that, how much infrastructure, how to divide the task without for that infrastructure, all of that is not for the user to do. So we think of pipeline as ourselves as kind of the pipeline optimizer, and declarative pipelines is the way to define it. So if you're only doing transformation to define a pipeline, it's a declarative pipeline. If you need to do orchestration and actually mess with the file system, then it's not a declarative pipeline.
All right, we actually have one more question here around schema changes. What happens if I have schema changes? Do I have to change that in the pipeline itself, or how does AppSolver manage that?
So there are a couple of ways to handle that. Okay, I'm not going to open the screen just for the sake of time, but there is a semi-automatic option and there is an automatic option. So let's say I had my e-commerce data and I created a sales dashboard. Now I want to add a column because there is a new field in the data. That field is automatically going to be mapped into the app solver schema on read. So if I'm going to share my screen, what you see here on the left, that field is automatically going to be added here, but it's still not in the output because I need to add it to my transformation. So what I need to do is to edit my pipeline, edit the SQL, and then I can rerun the pipeline. When I rerun the pipeline, I have the option to actually do backfill. So I can take historical data from the point in time I started seeing this new field and apply that to the target. I call this the semi-automatic option because it takes me a couple of minutes to do this change. Then I need to just, and then I can just click on run and everything including the backfill is already going to be done by Absolver. The automatic option would be to use an API to query statistics from Absolver, and we can compare fields in the schema with fields in my target. And I can apply some kind of logic that says, well, if I'm seeing a new field, automatically add that to the target. And I basically need to write a script with a few API calls and then it will happen automatically. The place we see that being applied is usually with CDC. So if I want to do CDC into Snowflake, then we will write a script that compares the target table. Sorry, not just to Snowflake, that applies to the data lake as well. But if I'm going to compare my target table with my source fields. And if I'm going to see a difference, I'm going to edit my pipeline and rerun it. And I wouldn't even have to do a manual operation like I'm showing here with the UI.
All right. And I think that's it for questions. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today and asking the questions. If you have more things you want to reach out to us about, please go to upsolver.com. If you want to learn more about the benchmark, it's going to be up on our blog at upsolver.com/blog, as well as the actual report itself behind it. Thank you very much, everyone, and have a great rest of your day.
Thank you very much, everyone.